it's me, Jessica McCaskill, WBC, WBA, super lightweight unified champion of the world. I wanted to give a big shout out to The Relay on YouTube. Check it out. Great boxing talk show. Has all the info that you need. Check it out. The Relay on YouTube.
The motherfucking Relay. We're covering today's top boxing news.
Okay, well, I'm sure that most of you have heard by now that Devin Haney's next matchup has been announced. It is going to be a WBC Eliminator. Final Eliminator towards a title shot at the WBC's green belt in the 135-pound division, the lightweight title. It's currently on the line in Vasyl Lomachenko's upcoming fight with Luke Campbell. Devin Haney is taking the next step in that direction. And he will be squaring off against Zaur Abdullaev on Friday the 13th in Madison Square Garden, New York City, as the main event of a card that really is a fantastic card. I mean, this card may seem like a sleeper to some if they're not familiar with all the fighters involved, but rest assured, this card has all the makings of what is a real treat. But let's talk about Devin Haney for a second and what he's got in front of him in Zaur Abdullaev. You know, I've had my first look at this guy. You know, and he seems like a guy with generous dimensions for the weight. You know, as far as lightweights go, Zaur would be on the bigger end of the spectrum. Not quite as statuesque as, say, I don't know, Masayoshi Nakatani. Because I don't even know how the fuck that guy makes weight. He's about 6'1", making 135 pounds. Jesus Christ.
Tough titty.
You know? But better still, Zaur is not a small, stumpy guy for the weight. He's actually got pretty generous dimensions as far as 135-pounders go. The thing is that this is not a nuanced fighter by any stretch of the imagination, and I don't say that to slight the guy. I'm just communicating and conveying to you guys what I see. And what I see in this guy is, you know, he's a statuesque guy, doesn't use it to the best of his ability. I mean, he does use his jab as a deterrent, but he doesn't really establish distance with it. He can't really control it. You see shots getting through on this guy. And what's funny about this guy is, you know, while he does use his jab as a deterrent, his sweet spot, where he likes to let his hands go, where he connects with his best punches, seems to be mid-range to inside as an aggressor closes the gap on him. You know, you see guys getting froggy with Zaur, and it's not uncommon for him to string together short punches mid-range to inside, and they do seem to have decent power on them, for what it's worth. I don't want to just take the piss out of the guy, you know, for no reason. But that does seem to be a sweet spot, mid-range to inside. And I think about that.
Think about it.
And what that denotes is that this is a guy that can be lured into, baited into situations. That as an opponent is coming on and being aggressive, it's a characteristic of Zaur's to open up and let his hands go once the opponent is mid-range to inside. You gotta think about that and how that can be used against him. This guy's jab from the outside, when he gets full extension off the punch, it's not very defensible. He doesn't establish and control distance with it. To top it all off, he sometimes doesn't keep those hands high enough, and he pays for it. That's from the outside. Mid-range to inside, this guy opens up.
Pay attention.
He throws short punches there. Good pop on him, but better still, this is where the guy opens up. So this
characteristic
kind of lends an insight into what a fight with him and Devin Haney might look like, because Devin Haney's a guy who can fight from a variety of ranges. Outside, inside, front foot, back foot, sideways. Devin Haney can do it all. I mean, this is why a lot of people are really high on this kid. So I'll be honest when I say that even though this situation is kind of similar to what we just saw in Teofimo Lopez versus Masayoshi Nakatani, similar in the sense that it's two undefeated guys climbing up the ranks looking to make a name for themselves, it's similar in that way, but in terms of what the aesthetic will be, the dynamic of the fight, I don't think this fight is going to be anywhere near as competitive as that fight was. I think this is going to be a lopsided victory for Devin Haney. Because while this situation features two undefeated up-and-comers, the same way Teofimo's fight with Masayoshi Nakatani featured two undefeated up-and-comers, the difference here is that, you know, Devin Haney's the more developed guy. He's the guy who's got more professional fights. I think he's at, what, 22-0 now? Whereas, you know, Zaur Abdullaev, he's only got about 11 professional fights. Biggest name he's fought so far is hammering Hank Lundy. In terms of experience, you know, because I'm not expecting Zaur to afford a killer. No, of course not. Not at 11-0, but better still, that is where his experience level is. You know, that's the most notoriable, formidable guy that he's fought. Hank Lundy. So in this situation, I see Devin Haney as the more developed prospect of the two. I see him as the more developed fighter who's got more nuances, more layers to his game, more ways to win. So I think it's safe to say, you know, these are preliminary thoughts. We'll get into maybe a more in-depth analysis as the fight date approaches. But for all intents and purposes, it really does look, at least on the surface, that Devin Haney's going to be able to box circles around this guy and take another step forward in what could be a fight that sees him challenging Vasyl Lomachenko for the green belt. Oh, I know, Vasyl doesn't have it yet, I know. But the odds are what they are, right? I mean, when you think about the Luke Campbell versus Vasyl Lomachenko fight, before you get into the dynamic and the aesthetics, I think a lot of people feel like, you know, Loma's got what it takes to win that fight. He's got what it takes to win that belt. And by the time that, you know, Devin Haney has worked his way to a title shot, by the time he gets past, you know, one or two more eliminators, it's conceivable that Vasyl Lomachenko is going to be in possession of that green belt.
By that time, yeah.
And that brings me to the next part of the conversation. You know, Devin Haney, he's a young guy.
20 years old.
I think that they should squeeze in some voluntaries. You know, they shouldn't just be eliminators that we see Devin Haney in. But we should see this guy fighting a couple more guys in between fights. Not necessarily for the entertainment of the fans, but the further development of him as a fighter. Because he's a very young guy. Shows a lot of promise. A lot of raw talent. But he's going to need discipline. He's going to need more than just natural gifts. He's going to need temperance if he is to square off against Vasyl Lomachenko sometime inside of, I don't know, what could be 3-4 fights. Yeah. You know, if it were to happen that soon, if that's the kind of schedule that they're on, then Devin Haney does need to squeeze in as much experience in the ring as he can to be fully prepared for a matchup against a guy like Vasyl Lomachenko. Yeah, I mean, I don't think that that's far-fetched at all. So, you know, I do think that Devin Haney is going to win this fight. I also think he's going to win it in very good fashion, lopsided fashion, spectacular fashion.
We look at the rest of the card, what it's comprised of. The unified super bantamweight champion Daniel Roman is going to be defending his two world titles against Akhmadaliev. Michael Hunter, who's only ever suffered one professional loss, and that was at the hands of Oleksandr Usyk, so that's nothing to be ashamed of. Michael Hunter is going to be squaring off against the undefeated heavyweight prospect, Sergey Kuzmin. That's a genuinely intriguing matchup. You wonder, is Michael going to give Sergey his first professional loss? You know, I remember seeing Sergey in there against Joey DeVaco, and I have to say that I really wasn't impressed with what I saw in Sergey. You know, he looked like a guy who needs more work, whereas Michael Hunter has swapped punches with the likes of an Oleksandr Usyk, and while he didn't win, he has that kind of an experience, in-the-ring experience, to draw from. You wonder if that kind of a situation doesn't make him a better fighter. You know, some fighters, they suffer a loss, they're never the same guy. Whereas other fighters, they suffer a loss, and they actually get better for it. That adds intrigue into this situation between Michael Hunter and Sergey Kuzmin. Sergey has not had the luxury of swapping punches with anyone as good, anywhere near as good as Oleksandr Usyk. Whereas Michael Hunter has, he has those experiences to draw from. And you know, since losing that decision to Oleksandr Usyk, what was approximately 5 fights ago, you know, Michael's on a 5 fight winning streak. Since losing that decision to Usyk, he bounced back. That shows character, that shows resolve, that shows the makeup of the fighter. You know, that first loss, it wasn't the end of the world for this guy. Since that time, he gave Martin Bacall his first professional loss. He managed to score a 9th-round TKO stoppage over Alexander Ustinov, guy with way more pro experience than either Michael or Sergey. You know, so that's saying something. That's saying something about where Michael is in his career, what he's doing now, how he's doing, and what his mental makeup might be ahead of this fight. I feel like even though both of these guys are making their bones and earning their stripes as up-and-comers, you kind of got to give Michael Hunter the edge in experience a bit. I mean, he really has fared better against the competition that he's faced so far, comparatively with Sergey Kuzmin. So, you know, overall, it is an intriguing matchup. It really is. But I have to say that the most intriguing matchup on the card, the fight that has the most potential to be a barn burner, to be an entertaining fight, a real dust-up, a real Donnybrook, is the fight between Heather Hardy, the WBO featherweight champion, and Amanda Serrano, what is a WBO super champion. What is the significance of that in this conversation?
Well, Amanda Serrano's last fight wasn't at featherweight.
Super flyweight.
Her last fight was at super flyweight for what was a vacant WBO title. But it being that Amanda Serrano has that WBO status of being a super champion, what that status essentially does is afford her the opportunity to travel to any weight class of her choosing and challenge whatever champion is in that weight class via the WBO. In this instance, it's Heather Hardy. So for Amanda, this is going to be a move upstairs from super flyweight to featherweight. I have a lot of thoughts on this fight, and I can't get them all out in one video. But what crosses through my mind the most is that this is honestly the best opponent that Amanda Serrano will have faced in a very long time. I mean, let's be honest. Look, Amanda's an accomplished fighter. I don't think that can be denied. But her resume really does leave a lot to the imagination when you have fought in so many weight classes but haven't fought the champions that were in those weight classes. As it stands, Amanda Serrano has fought in something like, I don't know, 7 weight classes, but she's only actually ever beaten 1 reigning champion.
7 divisions.
This fight with Heather Hardy was something that was talked about some time ago. It was something that they were playing with, the idea of staging a match between the two. And the idea was pitched to Heather Hardy, who was receptive to the fight, but at that time, that's as far as it went. A suggestion, a conversation. Whereas here we see the fight has materialized. And this is arguably the biggest fight of both of their careers. That's right. Understand that for Heather Hardy, it's not even a question of whether or not this is her toughest fight, her stiffest opponent, the biggest name on her resume. It's not even a question. It most certainly is. Amanda Serrano poses challenges for Heather Hardy, the likes of which Heather has not seen yet as a professional. Up until this point, the biggest name on Heather's resume was arguably Shelly Vincent. You think about it on the other end of the spectrum for Amanda Serrano. You know, Amanda, like I said, she's fought in a lot of weight classes. But I'd have to say that a win over Heather Hardy is the kind of a win that her resume really needs. Because up until this point, it's been mostly girls that are no-hopers in contention for vacant titles. What have been mostly vacant titles that a champion, a reigning champion, was not holding. So there's a lot to prove on either side of this thing. There really is. For both girls, there really is a lot to prove.
That's why it's a great fight.
And this will be Amanda Serrano's second fight of what is a 3-fight deal on DAZN.
Signed this deal back in October of last year.
And she only had one fight, which was that fight for that vacant WBO title way down there at, I think it was 115. You know, so this is the second fight of that deal. And I'll be honest, I'm going to be completely honest when I say this, and you can feel free to disagree. At this point in the juncture, I'm not even checking for Amanda Serrano versus Katie Taylor anymore. I'm not. I'd be happy seeing Amanda, you know, if she wins this fight with Heather, moving on from this to unify the division. I would be happy seeing that. I would be happy seeing Amanda if she wins this fight against Heather, moving into a fight
another champion
with the only unified champion at the weight, Jelena Marjanovic, who was in action in defense of her 2 world titles not that long ago. She is the WBA and WBC champion, the most experienced at the weight and the longest reigning champion at the weight. I would settle, and I don't even think I should classify it as settling. It's just that, in all honesty, the Katie Taylor fight for Amanda Serrano, it doesn't really seem like an important fight to her. A lot of the moves that she's been making as of late seem to be counterproductive moves. She just doesn't seem crazy about that fight. And you know what? If the fight don't happen, the fight don't happen. Katie Taylor's got plenty of other opponents that are ready and willing to take her on. For Amanda, however, if she wins this fight with Heather Hardy, if she procures the WBO title in the featherweight division, I really wouldn't mind seeing her square off against Jelena. I think that that's a fight that is long overdue. It's the kind of fight that Amanda Serrano has really been missing, and I wouldn't mind seeing that if she beats Heather. I mean, those really are my thoughts ahead of the fight. You know, I'll do a breakdown. I'll get into an analysis as far as what the dynamic and the aesthetic of the fight will be. But what resonates with me the most is that Amanda really needs to build something. Stop jumping through different divisions and picking up vacant titles and start off what is a real reign as a champion. A reign. Not holding the title for 10 seconds and then throwing it in the air, but actually reigning as the authority in a weight class. That's what I would like to see. And I'm hoping that if Amanda wins, that's what ends up happening. So, you know, my assessment on this fight, my assessment of this card overall is it's actually a really great fucking card. So keep your eyes peeled for this.
In September.
On Friday the 13th in September. It's not far away. And finally, The numbers are in for Adam Kownacki's fight with Chris Arreola this weekend, and I have to say that these are fantastic numbers, given the circumstances. Do realize that the name of Adam Kownacki is not one of the more talked about names in terms of the sport of boxing, or even just limited to the heavyweight division. Understand that Adam Kownacki is very much a guy who is in the building process of his profile. And yet, he was able to get this kind of viewership, which is made possible by staging a fight on Fox as opposed to Showtime. You know, 1,769,000 viewers is a solid number, given that there are no high-profile names on the card. Adam Kownacki versus Chris Arreola. Marcus Brown versus faded John Pascal. For what it's worth, the card turned out to be entertaining, but people didn't know that ahead of the fight, you understand? The card looked like your run-of-the-mill filler fight card.
Not much intrigue.
Experience fight for Kownacki, keep busy fight for Marcus Brown. That's how the card read ahead of the fight. So for it to have gotten this kind of viewership is very encouraging, but it does beg a question. If PBC's fighters can get this kind of viewership just by fighting on Fox, which reaches a lot of homes, I might add. But if they can get this kind of viewership just by fighting on Fox, regardless of who it is, that lends itself to building those fighters' profiles more so than having any of their guys fighting on fucking Showtime. I mean, you see the kind of numbers that Gervonta Davis is pulling in on Showtime, right? I mean, the only guy on Showtime, who the PBC's got fighting on Showtime, the only guy who's coming anywhere close to a million views for a fight is Deontay Wilder. Any other card they stage there puts up some very mediocre and unencouraging numbers, and you wonder that they're not
wasting their time
selling their fighters short by maintaining that professional relationship with Showtime. What are the pros of having their fighters fight on that network when so few people are seeing their fighters in action? And how long can this go on when the people at PBC have got to know if we put our guys on Fox, it lends itself that much more to building their profiles than if we continue to stage these cards on Showtime? How long can Showtime stay in the business of boxing when, you know, they don't seem to be doing PBC very many favors? Just in terms of getting these fighters seen, getting exposure for these fighters, for these fight cards, and for PBC as a brand. Showtime is not really fulfilling that role the same way that Fox is. Fox is getting these fucking guys watched. So you wonder how long this partnership can last. Will there be an extended agreement after this agreement is over? Because this engagement, it doesn't seem to be fruitful for either fucking Showtime or the PBC. Just being honest here, look, I normally take jabs at the PBC openly. I openly rib these guys for what bullshit goes on, you know, with their brand. But when I say this, you know, it's not coming from a biased place. It's coming from an objective perspective that these PBC guys, whatever the fuck they're doing, they really are better off doing it on Fox than Showtime. Because if you put them on Showtime, odds are, when the numbers come back, the numbers are going to be mediocre. That's what they're going to be.